Well, logic concludes that after my last top 10 video did so good, I should follow it up with another. My goal is to make a trilogy of my top 3 all-time favorite artists' 10 best songs. So next up after Taylor Swift is Eric Church, one of the most respected artists of the modern era of country music. One of the biggest divides many people struggle with in the Nashville scene is presenting a narrative most people can relate to, often which with country music are southern lifestyles, family values, rowdier nature. Some country music was capable of accomplishing some of that, but was really shallow and repetitive. Most country aficionados refer to this as the bro era of country music. On the other hand, you have the more intellectual listeners who want to actively think through their music. You have records like The Nashville Sound and The High Women that take on these compelling and thought-provoking themes which aren't really relatable to a lot of people. So while it may seem easy to some in order to blend the two demands together, in a modern age of country music, that job is inherently difficult. But Eric Church is one of the few artists in this day and age that, in my opinion, is capable of accomplishing both. His writing, while not as strong as artists like Laurie McKenna or Sturgill Simpson, I'd argue Eric's writing capabilities have come close. Often, Eric would embrace his more rowdy nature, providing us with these catchy and energetic tracks which also have some clever and subversive details and messages. Eric Church is a cornerstone of this channel, of course. The image of this channel is Eric Church. I don't want to say making this list was hard, because I really had this list made a long time ago, and it was relatively easy given how much I listened to him. So without further ado, here are, in my opinion, the 10 best songs to ever come from the Chief. Why not start this list off with one of the most beloved Church cuts, the powerful album closer of Mr. Misunderstood, 3-Year-Old. It's no secret that Mr. Misunderstood is for the most part a record of fatherhood, so many of the tracks are dedicated to themes of responsibility, empathy, impacting wisdom, and all of it comes to a soft end with 3-Year-Old, one of my favorite album closers ever, representing the final turn to one of the most compelling country albums of the decade. It's Eric's perspective of observing a child's day-to-day and what may seem like ordinary childish things, such as licking a mixing bowl or overuse of crayon colors, represents some of the most important wisdom we still carry in our lives, whether it be kindness, creativity, or love. The tone gives this imaginary, spacious vibe coinciding with how we observe the world as children. It has a neat contrast to the more grim and realistic tracks on the record, and ending it with such a playful and innocent track seems very fitting. We expect a lot of creative things from the Chief, but fatherly vibes at the time of this release wasn't one of them, and at least to me, it makes the song all the more special. Eric Church has always been one to tug at our heartstrings, but never from this direction before, highlighting the simple joys of our life having more meaning than what we perceive as the greatest moments or days. I like the almost hollow reverb we get in this track. It gives the atmosphere of this song so much more significant. It would be the pretty repetitive percussion. It sounds great, but a bit more variety rhythmically would have pushed the song much farther along. Beyond that, I don't know, man. Songs about the simple joys always get me. Eric's somber delivery just makes every line of the song so satisfying, and I especially love the progression of saying he learns it from a 3-year-old to finally his own 3-year-old. It's such a beautiful and touching end to an unbelievable album.
You're old.
Does The Outsiders have a lot of divisiveness surrounding it? Yes, definitely, and it absolutely deserves it. But for how many mediocre to even bad songs this album has, The Outsiders manages to have so many exceptional moments, with A Man Who Was Gonna Die Young being pretty close to the pinnacle of the album. I'd say this is the one Eric Church song where Eric pours his heart and soul into it. He may sound defeated, but it isn't in a lazy or negative way. It feels like the weight of mortality is crushing him in this song. The passion and sadness he presents in this song is awe-inspiring. The minuscule background instrumentals suit the song extremely well, because all that's really necessary in Eric telling the story the way he does. Eric was never the most emotional or powerful vocalist, but when this man puts this much lyrical magic into a song, it's truly breathtaking. I love how the song continues to stay grim up until the main guitar solo, where in an odd sort of way shifts into this hopeful outlook, with Eric going from grim and defeated before facing death to this optimistic and joyous promise. And how the opening guitar lick from the beginning is given new meaning without even changing its key. The lyrics just completely shift that simple phrase, which is honestly mind-blowing to me. I think years from now we will see this as Eric Church's eulogy or remembrance song, in a similar way for Hurt by Johnny Cash or He Stopped Loving Her Today by George Jones. I don't have problems with this song per se. It's a clean as hell performance from Church showing us what he does best. I just think other songs which do have more flaws reach even more insane heights. A Man Who Was Gonna Die Young is one of his lesser known songs, so I hope you check this one out. If mortality songs are your thing, give it a listen. It's absolutely stunning.
But the devil named music is taking my life.
You know, when formulating this list, it finally occurred to me that Eric doesn't have a lot of ballads. He has a lot of mid-tempo and upbeat songs, and sure, they're often great, but when people think of Eric Church, truth be told, I don't believe people think ballad. However, when this man serenades us with a power ballad, it's enough to knock your socks off. Mistress Named Music is simply bone-chilling. I know there are more emotional songs on Mr. Misunderstood, but this song deserves just as much love. And to me, this is a song that actually begins to drive the plot of this album forward, of Eric being caught up between the life of a rock star and the life of a father. And while he has familial responsibilities, and eventually chooses them over the world he's known for almost 10 years at this point, he treats the world of music as his mistress, something to succumb to, almost as if it's seducing him. I love how the song starts out relatively calm, but slowly continues to build in instrumentals, matching with how he gives more and more into the nightlife. And once he fully gives into this song, Eric and his band hold absolutely nothing back in what is one of the most triumphant moments in Eric Church's entire musical career. Instrumentally, this is probably the best song he's ever done. The choir accompaniment, the rocking guitar solo, and Eric finally letting loose, words cannot describe how insane it is. When Eric envelops that southern rock flair, he gives it all. Sure, the lyrics aren't the most profound, and I find the pacing of the first third of the song a little off, but I thought about it, and the thing is, I really don't care. It's one of his best ballads and one of the only songs that really introduce us to Eric Church, the person. Eric has a lot of phenomenal songs, but truth be told, I don't think he firsthand experienced murder ballads and being on death row. Here we get to see the emotional complexity of Eric, and what we do see is awesome.
In this world, you can either do things the easy way or the right way. You take a boat from here to New York. You gonna go around the horn like a gentleman or cut through the Panama Canal like some kind of Democrat?
In my top 10 Taylor Swift video, I said this. Much how I think Hippie Radio would be a great final song for Eric Church, I think Lover would be a great final song for Taylor Swift. And yeah, that still holds up. Hippie Radio kind of annoys me in a way that's not really a problem with the song. I just wish this was the ending of Desperate Man so bad, because it wraps up the themes and conflicts present in the past three Eric Church albums up to this point. Not only that I consider this Eric's best storytelling song, the way he goes from being a kid to a young adult and wrapping up these two plot points in the final chorus is just insane. We get to see him as a kid connecting with his dad using the radio, him as a teen connecting with his girlfriend, and finally reaching a point where he is now a father and a husband. It's truly beautiful, while also wrapping up the themes of putting his family first over the world of music. Even though this is his life now, Hippie Radio acknowledges music is still a part of his life and drives a lot of it forward. Soul wishes it could come even close to the amount of soulful influence this song has. There are people that genuinely think Soul is better than Desperate Man, and I just point to this song. It seems a fatherhood, adoration of music, and his love for both finally reaching a sense of balance and clarity is such a major point for Eric's life. If this was the final song ever written and recorded, I wouldn't have a problem with that. It's such a perfect ending to Eric's musical career. How many artists can truly have a perfect ending like this to their music? The years of buildup, the fleshed out stories, all coming to this. It may not be the ending to Eric's career, but it's definitely the end of this chapter, this saga of Eric Church's life.
Yo dudes, the Empire's pretty chill. Maybe you could like join it or something.
When I think about the pinnacle of The Outsiders, it's often the most debatable of any of his albums. Some people think A Man Who Was Gonna Die Young is the best, or Talladega, and you have your weirdos who think The Joint is the best song. Please, for the love of God, keep it to yourself. But in my opinion, the peak of The Outsiders is Dark Side. I've had a difficult time pinpointing what exactly The Outsiders is about. Eric himself has tried to give it a more conceptual narrative, one I couldn't really identify. The best I can come up with is that Eric throughout the album tries to isolate himself through a lot of the drama and personal relationships, trying to keep his inside from coming out. And at least to me, Dark Side represents that breaking point on the record, where his dark side finally gets to come out, where these things finally make him snap, and not immediately during the song. The song starts out with some marching rhythm that's relatively calm, with Eric in the same temper as well, calm and collected, but the darker the scenario Eric puts this in gets, the song gets bit by bit more tense. Even before Mr. Misunderstood, Eric began displaying familial values with this promise to protect his son. And that ending. holy hell. I won't spoil it because it's something you should experience for yourself. I can see people going into this song and immediately saying, yuck, this is one of the more nuanced songs where you really have to think about everything. But once you do, Dark Side really turns into something mind-blowing. I'll be the first to admit it's on the more simplistic lyrical side of things, but I like to think of it as a song that says and does so much by not doing anything at all. In a way, its less intensity in contrast to the rest of the album makes it even more intense than any song on the project. Please give this one a listen. It deserves so much more love than it currently gets. Monsters is a weird one to talk about, honestly. When a lot of people think of this song, they think, yeah, it's great, but is it one of the best Eric Church songs? Yes. Yes, it is. Monsters immediately uses imagery to give this sense of use and face extremely well. With monsters under the bed and using a maglite, it shifts from this song about a boy conquering his own fears to a grown man grappling with the demons of the world, including his own inner demons. Eric truly knows how to correlate two different scenarios that give so much meaning to the other, making it so satisfying. How we may evolve and grow, but the monsters don't disappear. They just take new forms and identities. Fear is an emotion we don't get rid of. People aren't brave because they have no fear. They are brave because they have the will to face it. And that's what Monsters is to me. The way Eric ties it to his facing God is so powerful, and is something I believe a lot of Christians can enjoy. I love that the song is in the perspective of him facing his fears as a child, to eventually evolving into him facing his fears as a growing and complex individual, to having to repeat the cycle and helping his son face similar challenges. All delving back to that theme of fatherhood, which at this point, we can all agree, is Church's go-to narrative the past few years. And unlike other artists that can run a narrative dry, Eric continued to find ways to reinvent the wheel with his stories and musical concepts. Sure, the blaring guitar is kind of pointless, but it's built up pretty effectively. Monster stands tall for its powerful message, brilliant progression, and exceptional buildup. I'd honestly call Monsters the blueprint in making a great Eric Church song. Eric's level of lyrical progression, rock flair, and enthusiastic vocals are at such a consistent level here, I hope he can build upon the formula he used for this song. I'm sure a few people believe that this isn't close to their top 5, but I adore it, y'all. Is when you think Tim McGraw. I must be totally fair and objective here. Springsteen is still better than Monsters. It was at this point in his career, Eric went from a fun outsider to one of the genre's top talents, the underdog becoming the star. Springsteen tells a tale of such a beautiful, layered, vivid, and colorful story surrounding distance, time, yet are still connected to their love of Bruce Springsteen. It was one of Eric's first showings of his adoration for classic music within his own. And like, who doesn't love Springsteen? Oh, this guy? Who the frick even cares? Unlike most hit songs naming tracks we deal with on the daily, Eric actually uses the various song titles to actually delve into the emotions on display, to give us this imagery of summer young love, using Born in the USA to acknowledge all the time that has passed since then as they are in different places now. This is everything these new songs should be, rather than just them naming them baselessly for baseless sake. I really only see one issue arising when it comes to this song, and that's the percussion. I love this song as much as everyone else, but even I have to call out its incredible simplicity. I get that's how a lot of Bruce's music was modeled, but it's not like it was that good there. I just wish this song got more percussion variety than it actually did. But apart from that, the instrumentals of this song take me back to a time in life I never lived. That's how good they are with their nostalgia factor. The guitar chords, the simple presses on the piano. It's a tsunami of nostalgia greater than the first two Taylor albums combined. I know I've been focusing a bit more on the deep cuts and underrated singles, but Springsteen stands out to me as one of the more profound and ages so well every single day. A modern day country classic coming from one of the most prolific songwriters. And keep in mind, this is number 4 on the list. We still got to get to the top 3, which are some of my favorite songs of all time. But before that, some honorable mentions. From Sinners Like Me, I'm basically tied with Two Pink Lines and Sinners Like Me. The emotions hit harder with Sinners, but Two Pink Lines' story's better. I don't know, you choose, they're both great. From Carolina. It's a little sad no song from this album made it on here, but Carolina is awesome and so is its album. I have a video essay on it that you can check out right after the video is over. From The Outsiders, Like a Wrecking Ball. I normally dislike sex jams, but this one's pretty good. From Mr. Misunderstood, Kill a Word. Another lyrical masterpiece that has aged incredibly well given the age we currently are in. from Desperate Man, Some of It. It may have similar themes to the other two songs from that album on here, but Some of It has its own unique attributes. And from Heart and Soul, Stick That in Your Country Song. It may not make sense on the project, but it's awesome, so soon. These are my honorable mentions. I'm not even gonna lie, there are a few more mentions that I could see earning a spot on here, but we don't have all day. Maybe if I rank every Eric Church song, we can get to them, but oh well, back to the top three.
You know, cause thunder always comes after lightning.
The popping off point for Eric Church to some is kinda hard to pin down, because we all know it started with Smoke a Little Smoke. But quality-wise, what was the first major sign that Eric was a visionary songwriter in the world of country? Well, the answer is simpler than you think. Lightning easily takes the cake for the beginning of Eric Church. Not only for its quality, but Lightning was the reason Eric Church got his record deal in the first place. But radio thought the song was too much for people to handle, and they ended up leaving it as an album cut. I thought going through this ranking, I was gonna make it without crying. I made it past the wholesomeness of 3-year-old, the sadness of a man who was gonna die young. Nothing was capable of doing anything to me. And then of course, I got to Lightning. Lightning is a story on the death penalty, and man, does this song sing its hooks into you real quick. From its swampy opening and the moment those somber guitar chords come in, this song wastes no time eviscerating your heart with this overwhelming feeling of sorrow. Already, Eric in the beginning of his career shows his skills in story progression, relaying us with these vivid details of the jail, taking us back to the night where this character shoots a boy. And while I don't feel bad for this character, the way this song delivers all this information just hits me in a way that's hard to describe, especially as someone who is a supporter in getting rid of the death penalty. I think what makes this song hurt more as it goes along are the simple lyrical changes that, albeit simplistic, drastically change the tone and direction of the song, like switching God and living my life this way being replaced with his daughter and leaving her this way. So more and more we get to that fateful pulling of the switch, rather than have the song continuously build suspense as this person's life is reaching its end, it does something much more profound. It actually lessens the suspense as this person has accepted his fate, and once we reach that dramatic pause, I just lose it. It's one of my favorite moments ever in my time listening to music. Something so carefully built up, so incredibly powerful. Words can never do that moment justice. Some might find Eric trying to give sympathy to this protagonist a little selfish, but I find it in a way necessary. We know this person is in the wrong, but is it worth his life? And that's what I truly think the message of Lightning is trying to get across. There is no easy answer. It's not a black and white scenario. It's incredibly gray, which is what I would call the tone of the song. And for a world that's questioning the death penalty's place in said world, this song has aged incredibly well and provides an incredibly needed social commentary on the way our society functions. If you're someone who's only listened to Chief and any album after that, and you've never gotten to Eric Church in the first place, this should be yours, and truth be told, everyone's introduction to Eric Church's discography.
Feast your eyes on your new business, knives.
Okay, I just want to clarify that my number 2 pick on this list is the best Eric Church song, and that my number 1 pick is my favorite. I always try to put what I believe is the critical best, but for this time I thought, screw that. And with that said, my number 2 song is Knives of New Orleans. Yep, I know, how predictable. Everyone has this labeled as the best thing Eric Church has ever done, to a point where what is there really to add? I'd rather be honest with myself and talk about what means the most to me. Because like I said previously, murder ballads are kinda hard to relate to. But yeah, Knives of New Orleans is all of Eric's previously mentioned skills heightened to such an insane degree. The story progression, the extremely hyped up energy, all of it comes together in this dark, moving, and really unique song from Eric. Truth be told, there really was nothing like Knives New Orleans at this point, and arguably there still isn't anything like it. At this point in country, murder ballads kinda ceased from the talking point in the genre, so to have it revived in such a bold and refreshing way is awesome. The incredible level of detail Church provides in this song and its various nuances is so well done. From wanting to wish for wings with a quarter in a wishing well, to escape not only from the law, but truth be told, his own conscience. As the song goes along, this person processes whether or not they feel an ounce of guilt, and slowly but surely, that feeling becomes more prominent as the song goes along. At this point in his career, it shouldn't be understated Eric's mastery of progression and wordplay. Calling tonight's bleeding memory tomorrow's guilty vein, being haunted by headlights and a crescent city breeze, turning already dark lines into something even darker with haunted by your hazel eyes. The thrilling chase the band provides is awesome, its thrumming energy is pulse pounding. The moment the first guitar stroke comes in, you know exactly what this song is going to be, and it is magnificent. When Eric lets loose at the climax, it's just so satisfying. Knives of New Orleans never lets up with the intensity once it starts. I think Jay Joyce needs more praise. This could have easily turned into another Joey Moy or Cole Wetzel hollow rock song, but this man provided such a great balanced experience, and he really should get more thanks for what he accomplished here. It's dark, it's haunting, lyrically the best thing he's ever done in his entire career. It's gosh darn Knives of New Orleans. What the hell else needs to be said? Yep, you knew this was coming. Mr. Misunderstood, without a doubt, takes the cake for my favorite Eric Church song. Where do I even begin, honestly? When I first heard this song in 2015, that was a moment of music that has yet to be topped in my personal opinion. Had I heard critically better songs up to this point? Oh yes, absolutely. But this song truly separates what I critically respect to what I just outright adore. There are many pieces of art where I can outright respect what was being done and admire its artistic attributes, like Kendrick Lamar's To Pimp a Butterfly, but it's songs like Mr. Misunderstood that make me and my identity as a person feel seen, which is what, in my personal opinion, art is for, to see ourselves, our lives, our personalities portrayed in it. I don't think this is the best Eric Church song, but it just means more to me than Knives New Orleans or Lightning ever could. Eric does what he does best, take a place of empathy and understanding. Highlighting his personal upbringing tries to relay it to us as a listener. I was in a pretty low headspace at the time the song was released, and it instantly sold me on its message. I was different. I was the one guy who listened to country, with Taylor being my only artist when it came to popular music. Not only did I not like it because of its sound, I just couldn't connect with it. And Mr. Misunderstood reassures the reason of why I love country music as much as I do. For the stories, the emotional resonance. It isn't enough to just have a relatable message, a lot of songs have that, but Eric goes the extra mile in doing a song with constant progression, not really pinning down an actual chorus, just constant verses showing how he lived. And despite all the problems that may arise from being different, he's telling you it's okay, you're not the only one who's different. And going from Mr. Misunderstood to the phrase of I understand, well, it's probably my favorite thing in music ever. Musically, it's also really impressive. The song is capable of expressing the somberness of feeling alone in its slower moments, to the absolute joys of being your own self. Once the song picks up speed, and that final minute to me is purely a celebration of embracing one's identity. Very few artists are capable of fully enveloping themselves in music. And for me, Eric Church is this song. He is Mr. Misunderstood. All of his ideals, all of his themes and his music, all go into this song, and I just can't thank this song enough. It helped a lot through the more difficult portions of my life. Mr. Misunderstood is without a doubt my favorite Eric Church song. It isn't even close. It isn't just the magnum opus of Eric Church, but it's also my number one favorite song of all time.